Jesus at the center of it all.
Okay, it's been some time since I've stood up here. First thing I always do is always go and see all the lovely people here. You know, today we are coming to the last in a series of Acts, okay? Who knows the two characters on that is put up there? What are their names? Woody and Buzz Lightyear. Okay, Susanna, very familiar. And in the show, they are actually partners, right? They are partners. So those of you who watch Toy Story, I mean, you all know. Those who haven't watched Toy Story, I think you should go and watch. There are three Toy Story, 1, 2, and 3. Very, very good, wholesome show. Very funny also, right? So today we are going to look at Acts 11, 19 to 13, verse 4. There will be different... portions. Sorry, somebody waving to me. John, the feedback is a bit high. A bit. Okay, so we're going to look at Acts 11, 19 to 13, verse 4. There will be verses that I'm picking in between, all right? So we are actually recapping. I want to recap now what we have been going through. How many of you know how many sermons we have been that we've covered actually in the Acts series? Any volunteers? How many have we done? 9. What else? 5 or 6? 5. Okay. The first one was an introduction, basic about how the church was born. And then we look at the first sermon of Peter, when he stood up and 3,000 were saved. And then we also looked at how there was refreshment in God's house, not only spiritually, but also in terms of resources and power, you know, for believers. And then how there was awe and power present, that people didn't play with the church, don't play, you know. When the believers gathered together, when people try and cheat the church and then they died. And so it is serious power, okay? And then Susan Hoover talked about the manifestation of power in the name of Jesus. So there is great power in the name of Jesus. And so they saw it in the early church. And then number 6, how the gospel spread was unstoppable. Okay, we look at how the gospel moved out, all right, even though there was persecution in the church. And how the King Herod or whoever, they tried to destroy the church. All right, tried to kill different ones, but you know, it continued to grow. And then we look at the first martyr, Stephen. And how he was stoned to death, and yet through that, the Paul, right? Paul, or rather Saul at the time, he was present. That was the first, in a sense, the time that his name was mentioned in relation to the church. And then the example of how God used Philip supernaturally. The eunuch was in a chariot and moving very fast, and then Philip ran up alongside it and then got in. You know, imagine how surprised the eunuch was. Okay, and so after that, we look at the conversion of Paul, the minister to the Gentiles. So 9, 10 already, you all can see the space, I space it there. And then 11, inclusion of the Gentiles. So we look at how Cornelius incident. And then 12, we look at Peter's miraculous escape. So far, we have actually covered 12 weeks all right, in this Acts series. That's quite long. 12 weeks is actually 3 months, but because we had Easter and all that, so a bit longer. Now, today is the final in the whole series. So the story continues. You see, as we look at how God started the church, all the things that God set in place, then I think how I would like to look at today's sermon is looking at what is it that God left in the church to let it grow further. Okay? And so the story continues where the partnership model is actually the model that God has set up for the growth and the perpetuation of the church. And so we look at Paul and Barnabas in particular. Okay, before we read, let's just pray. Father, I just thank you. I commit this sermon, this time to you. And Father, it is your words that will speak and impact us. Lord, I commit the speaker and the hearer, Lord, everyone who is here, that we will benefit from this sermon and that it will speak to one particular area in our life that we need to hear from you. All of us are all different, and yet, Lord, we are all your children. I thank you that power will go forth. Refreshment, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, I'll read for you all. Acts 11. Now, those who were scattered after the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, preaching the word to no one but the Jews only. So at the time, the Jews only. But some of them were men from Cyprus and Cyrene, who when they had come to Antioch, spoke to the Hellenists, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed and turned to the Lord. Why I put red color, hand of the Lord was with them, this is actually partnership, isn't it? Where God's hand, God was the partner together with them. And so God's hand was with them, and when they preach, a great number. You see, the Bible doesn't exaggerate. When the Bible says somebody is beautiful, that person is beautiful. When the Bible says somebody is very beautiful, then the person is extremely beautiful, okay? One very there is a big difference. Okay, so just so you know. So a great number, many people believed and turned to the Lord. Then news of these things, many people who are the Gentiles, right, came to the, this news of the conversion of these Gentiles came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas out to go as far as Antioch because they were hearing, hey, a lot of non-Jews are believing, you know. How come? So they sent Barnabas out to go and check it out, make sure it's kosher, you know, make sure it's really true or not. Are they believing some other gospel? And when he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad and encouraged them all that with purpose of heart they should continue with the Lord. So he saw what was happening. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and a great many people were added to the Lord. So Barnabas' name is actually son of encouragement. His name Barnabas is son of encouragement. Later I'll talk a little bit more about him, but basically Barnabas was the one that, if you remember, Ananias and Sapphira, you know, right? The one who gave. So the verse before that, Barnabas was actually, his name was actually called Joseph, like Joseph, Joseph. And he was the one that sold his land first. And I mean, actually many of them sold their land, but it was stated that in the Bible that he sold his land, brought the money and put it at the feet of the apostles. And then the apostles called his name Barnabas, son of encouragement, because it was a great encouragement to them that somebody would sell their land and then bring all the money and give to them. And so they were very encouraged, all right? And so, of course, other people try and copy, Ananias and Sapphira. I mean, okay, not other people, just them. Because the church is very big and, you know, much like TNCC, we welcome everyone. We don't do background checks on you. Go to CTOS and CCRIS and check whether you're bankrupt or not. We don't do that because, you know, the church is for everyone. Everyone is welcome from all strata of society, all right? Because God loves everyone. And then, okay, moving on, 24, verse 24, he says, "For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith." The Bible says, "Good man." All right, good man means he's good, lah. I think his heart is good. Okay, and he was full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. Okay, so again, the Bible doesn't mince words. So this gives you a bit of background into Barnabas. All right. And a great many people were added to the Lord. So, because of his involvement, a great many people were added to the Lord. But then you look at the next verse. Then Barnabas departed for Tarsus to seek Saul. Before he changed his name to Paul, it's called Saul. All right? So Barnabas, in a sense, was an encouragement to the church. He was, you know, an emissary, so to speak, from the main church, from the apostles in Jerusalem. And he was a good encourager. He was a man full of the Holy Spirit. And he was a man of faith. And then many people were added to the Lord. There was great success. But the next thing the Bible records is, he went to look for Saul. Why? I thought somebody who is a great evangelist or something like that would you know, don't need help, lah. I just do, lah. I'm very good, I do, lah. But the Bible says here that Barnabas departed for Tarsus to seek Saul. And when he had found Saul, he brought him to Antioch. So it was that for a whole year, they assembled with the church and taught a great many people. And the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. This is another pointer to the importance of partnership. Because I believe that Barnabas, even though he was doing the good work, the Holy Spirit must have spoken to him and told him, go to Tarsus to get Saul. It is an instruction from the Lord. He heard what God said and he went. And that's God's purpose. You know, if man does it, man, you know, all of us, we are, how to say, it's always people-centric. Not people-centric. It is always a man-centric. Huh? So if the leader is very good, then the thing flourishes. But the moment the leader, you know, changes or passes away or something, then everything all go to pieces. In the world, it's like that. Right? In the world, it's like that. So, for example, you see World War II. It is because of a very charismatic leader, Adolf Hitler, that he can, you know, have such a huge war machine. But when it started to crumble and they got him, then finished, like, everything all gone. The world system is always one man, me, self-made. I'm the man, you know, always like that. But God's way is different, okay? So anyway, moving on. I skip Acts 12. Don't worry, I'm not reading through the whole chapter. All right, now, so Acts 13. Now in the church that was at Antioch, there were certain prophets and teachers. So all the names there, Barnabas and all that, and then Saul. Saul is last, I put there, and Saul. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit said, "Now separate to me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." So there was work. Then having fasted and prayed, they laid hands on them and they sent them away. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia and from there they sailed to Cyprus. So actually what was happening? You see, the gospel spread from Jerusalem all the way to Antioch. Then Antioch was all, where all the non-Jews were believers. And then, you know, they continued preaching and a great many people were added to the group. And because of this partnership, and then further from this, now this place in Antioch is now sending out Paul and Barnabas to go and further spread the gospel. All right? Okay. So you all know the setting. This is the context. So I would like, the first point I would like to make is that partnership was designed by God. Why do I say partnership was designed by God? You see, if you notice, I think you heard this say, Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship, right? We've said this many times, but as we progress in our faith with God, we realize that this is actually true. Because, you know, Christianity is about relationship other religions are about rituals. Do you get what I mean? Christianity is about relationship. The rest of the religions that we see are about rituals, doing something, performing this, doing that, doing that, doing that. In the past, Judaism seems to be like that as well. All right, about rituals, you need to do a lot of things. But actually, the true reason, the true nature is of Christianity is a relationship. Because why? Because God is a relational being. You understand? You see, God created, you see, before everything started, there was God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. There was relationship. There was partnership. There was interaction going on. And then God said, let us create man in our image. He wanted fellowship with man. So He created man for what? To build bigger cities, to make money, to convert people to Christianity? No, right? What did He build, make man for? Fellowship. Because God is relational. So actually, all of us are created as relational beings. We are created for relationship. Primarily with God, but also with each other. And therefore, I say, partnership was designed by God. You see, as we progress in our faith, as we understand more about grace, we're actually moving from independence to dependence. It seems backward, right? I think I've said this before. I say, I train my baby so hard to be independent, then when he knows God, then he must go backwards and become dependent again. Huh? There's a bit of a, you know, I was thinking, hey, you know, you train them so hard, hey, you must walk on your own, nah, no need to hold my hand, nah, you're big enough already. Hey, you must eat, nah, I don't have to hold your hand to eat, you must be independent. Then later, you must train them to become dependent on God when they're so independent. Huh? I want to do it my way now. Now I have to do it God's way. How? But that is the journey of understanding and becoming dependent on God. Whereas other religions are talking about independence, actually, right? Because, you know, the monk or whoever, I mean, whoever is more advanced or, you know, they're advanced and they're able to achieve, to reach a certain place. That is independence. He achieved it on his own. He achieved, you know, nirvana, example, on his own. You cannot achieve it with other people. He achieved on his own. It's independence on your own. But for us, it is dependence, growing in dependence on God. And secondly, it actually, our faith actually talks about moving from isolation into growing interdependence on one another. Rather than going away, you know, like a hermit or whatever, go away to be alone, to achieve whatever, to meditate, to all that, right? And then spending time alone. Actually, partnership, or what God has made, is for us to grow in terms of interdependence with each other. This is the reason why you cannot sit alone at home and listen to sermons and say you have gone to church. Revelation, No. No, but this is the reason. The reason is because God has created partnership for us to be with one another. So isolation is not good. Because when you are isolated, what happens? The enemy can single you out and take you down. Very easy. All right? Next. There are many examples of partnership. So you have talked about the Trinity, how the Holy Spirit works in us, with us, the relationship between husband and wife, the male and the female, where the husband, you know, is good at certain things and then the wife is good at other things, and when they come together, actually, it's amazing. When husband and wife have, with the individual strengths, all right, are able to complement one another, it is one of the strongest human partnerships that we will see. Okay? That's why they say behind every successful man is a successful woman. All right? Together, we are able. That's why God says, your relationship with your wife must be good. Then your prayers will be answered. That's what the Bible says. Huh? Okay, I mean, for those who have wives, husband and wives. But I realized for myself, I realized that this is true. When I fight with my wife, I tell you, very susah one. It's like inside here, I got something, you know. The whole day you're carrying it around with you, you know. And so you have to go and settle it. Then you feel, you can do things lah, okay? So anyway, example. Then also in terms of the biblical partnerships, you look at Joshua and Caleb. You look at David and Jonathan. You look at Paul and Barnabas. You look at Paul and Silas. Paul and Titus. You see? I'll talk about this later. Many examples. So, the next point I'd like to say is, in God's eyes, partnership is more important than the goal of partnership. Partnership is more important than the project. In the world, what do? We form JV, right? For a project. So what happens is the world is always, we form a partnership in order to achieve something. That means I have my skill set is this. I see this other company, the skill set is different. I want to do this thing. I need their skill set. You know, I got capital, they got the experience. I JV with them. Partnership. But only for the purpose of that project. You understand? I'm not saying that this is a bad thing. I'm just saying that this is the way the world works. But God works differently. God works. The partnership is the goal. All the other result of the partnership is fruit of the partnership. Okay? So the stronger or the deeper the partnership, the greater the potential for success. And this one we also see lah. You know why? Okay, why I say this is, if this is not the case, you will end up where people make use of people. You understand? I partner you. Hey, yeah, bro, good. But actually, I'm using you to get something. And if we do this outside, and if we do this in the house of God, then I think you all have seen this happen before, right? Have you all seen it happen before where brothers use brothers to get something? Then after finish, drop them. It has happened. Because we put the cart before the horse. Alright? So this is the purpose of the church. Now, I don't know, this is something I haven't fully understood yet. But you see, why do we come here every Sunday? Why do you come here on Sunday? Come here, jang, 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 jang. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And then after that, announcement, and then sermon, and then go home. Why do we come here? It may seem that way to you. It may seem like, this would be called a ritual. If we come here, the practice that's ongoing every Sunday. What you see with your physical eyes. But today, I want to challenge your thinking about why you come to church. This church that God has built has lasted for 2,000 years. And this church is the body of Christ that will last forever. Nothing is going to be able to break the church, because the church is the body of Jesus Christ. And so, if it is that powerful, and we all say amen to this, I would like to challenge our notion about why are you coming to church on Sunday? Is it just Sunday or not? What else is it? There must be something more if this is such a powerful truth, right? We're talking about partnership. The church is the model to show the world what God, the way God wants, God relates to us and how we relate to each other. This is the purpose of the church. Okay, move on. In the church or in a partnership, all right, that we're talking about, Jesus is the center and the basis. I would not be in spiritual partnership with you as a brother if I did not believe in Jesus, right? Only when you believe in Jesus, someone else believe in Jesus, then you have the basis for partnership with one another. Spiritual partnership. So it's not a, it's actually quite exclusive, you know, so to speak, lah. Because you must believe in Jesus. Believe in Jesus, then you are partners. Now, the other side is also true. Somebody that you cannot stand his face, in church, physically, he's also your partner. Because you are partners when you believe in Jesus together. You see? And so I need us to look, not I, God wants us to look at the relationship and the partnership with each other as something beyond our fleshly eyes. Okay, you all remember last time when we used to play balloon acar, you know, balloon, where you have a pathway and then there are two teams and then you need to block the guy from going through, right? If you know, so we have two poles the whole way, then it's like capture the flag. So the guy must try and run through the thing and you must try and tag him and then he's out. So what we will do is, we have two leaders and then big group of people, then you one, two, zoom. Okay, I choose this guy. What happens? All the best are taken first, right? This is the fastest guy. This one, the most wriggly guy. You cannot get him. This one is what? Oh, I like this guy. He's my best friend. Then only left all the, so to speak, weak ones. Then they always feel very bad. I don't have no choice. I have to take him, you know, that kind of thing. Sometimes that happens in the church as well. We look at each other only based on our strength. I like him only because he's strong. He's handsome. He's good at playing the guitar. He's a good worship leader. I don't want to be in the team of this person because I don't like her. I don't like him. You know? I don't want to serve together. You know, we have this kind of issues where the personality becomes the key reason for whether you want to be in partnership with the person or not. I'm saying this, I'm not, how to say, deluded lah. I know, you see, we are human beings and that you have a preference on lah. It's normal. But what I'm saying is that the goal that God has is for us to look beyond the physical to what God has made us to be in Christ Jesus. To see that potential in each other. You understand or not? So right now, this person is unlovely. But Jesus died for him. He has believed in Jesus. There is a new life in him. He is my partner. And I believe that God is going to work in his life. And he is going to change and become a partner to someone else. To encourage others. Do you all get it? So this church is a gathering of non-perfect people in the flesh but who have a perfect father and who are actually spiritually perfect because the Holy Spirit lives in us. If we are not perfect, the Holy Spirit cannot live in you. Right? So the Holy Spirit lives in you. God, your spirit man has been made with the same life as Jesus. Your life is the same as Jesus. It's just your physical body that we are housed in here and the mind that we have. That's why this mind needs to be changed. That's why this word that I'm speaking today is important for all of us to understand this as a beginning of the changing of mind in relation to this particular area. Do you all get it or not? Was that last sentence too long? Basically, this is the beginning. If you listen carefully to what I'm saying, this is the beginning of your mind being changed in relationship to our people in the church. Okay? This guy talk too much. This guy so quiet. This guy, you know, always isolated, don't like to meet people. This guy always late. This guy, hey, hello. we are all imperfect lah. Okay? Alright, moving on. So, with all this imperfection, what is it that binds us? You see, partnership in the world is bound by what? Your shareholders' agreement. Right? Huh? Or in a housing area, huh? Your deed of mutual covenants, the DMC. Everybody covenants that we will pay our maintenance fee on time. We will keep the place, the demise premises clean. La 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 la. Long list, right? Then got people don't pay la, got all sort of thing, right? So it's always based on contract. What binds you together? Contract. What binds the church together? The love of God. Stronger than any contract. In the Bible it says that love is stronger than love is stronger than death. That's what the Bible says. I think in Song of Solomon. Jesus loved us so much that he died and he rose again for us. It is this love that is the basis of the relationship in the church, of the partnership that we have in Jesus. So you are not able to love someone. Let me tell you that our physical love, I mean our own ability to love is like that. Cannot one, no matter how I psych myself, I cannot love that guy. You know? His mannerism just petahan. You know, I mean, there's just some people that rub us the wrong way, right? But when you realize that your love is not strong enough, then you revert. You say, Father, I cannot love him. I've reached the end of my limit. But you love him, just like you love me. Let your love flow through me to him. That's how we partner with one another. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. And the next verse says, by this love will all know that you are my church. It is the love that will differentiate this partnership to the rest of the world. Do you understand? And this love is special because it is only in the body of Christ. Because outside you love someone who does not know Jesus, you love them, all right? But they cannot love you back with the same kind of love of Jesus until they become a child of God. They are attracted by this love that they see in the church. Okay? So now I want to look at the definition of partnership or partner, fellow workers. The word here is actually synergos, from the word synergia. Does that sound like a similar word? Exactly. The word is synergy. That's amazing. I didn't know that, no? That means, right, partnership, the Greek word that is used for laborer, fellow laborer, companion in labor, partnership, where the Bible says, if you go and look it up, it says, you know, we are God's fellow workers. We are fellow laborers in this field that God has called us to be in. This fellow laborer word is actually the word synergos, which is synergy. Synergy means what? 1 plus 1 equals 5. Example. The combined effect is greater than the sum of its parts. So when believers come together, there is great, great power. And for too long, we have been happy just to come to church on Sundays. Brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, look beyond this. There is something in the midst of us here that is so powerful and so explosive that when it is revealed or when the fire touches it, the power is so great. Because if you look in Acts, how the gospel spread is amazing. Dead raised to life. Is that power or not? Sick, healed. Lame, walk. Blind, see. No financial needs. Cover this side, cover this side, cover this side. That is God's purpose for the church. It is very powerful. And I believe that this message comes at a time when for all of us to rethink our previous notion about church. So there is a power tap. When there's partnership, you are tapping into power. Even in the worldly sense, all right, if you partner a billionaire in a project, you know that there will be money lah for the project, right? That's why everybody wants to partner a rich partner lah, okay? Or a partner that can get things done, got the experience. You're tapping into that power. You're tapping into that experience to get things done, to meet your goal. This is from the commercial sense, we understand that. But let me tell you, when your partner is God, who's your partner? Ah? Oh, my partner is Microsoft. Or who's your partner? My partner is Google. Who's your partner? Ah? Oh, my partner is God. Whoa. Who's your partner? You think your partner is God? Ah? Yeah, actually, he's God. Let me tell you that. Our partner is God. Can you imagine? What do we have to give to him that he wants to partner us? That's why I'm saying it's not the project that he sees. Oh, I want to evangelize the whole world. Ayo, no choice lah. These 11 guys have to partner them. No other people to partner. You sometimes you think, right? Why did God choose the 11 disciples? 12 disciples, I mean. And then one of them, all sorts of things, right? And yet, you see where the gospel is today. And I believe at the end of the age, when the time is coming, when the church realizes this, the grace of God and the love of God in the church, when the world sees this, when the church sees this herself, there will be great, great, great harvest. People will come to know God. Actually, there are many people who are coming to know God already now. The Spirit is working. This is part, we are all just part of this little jigsaw puzzle that God is putting together, you know, for the end time, for the final days, where we will see an incredible conclusion. Right now, you see, the world is in chaos. Oil price seesaw, stock markets up and down. Haze, fire in Indonesia, Malaysia, all the problems that we have. We see all these things happening. We ask God what's happening, right? Then God says this message. He's partnering us. All these things here is to drive people to the Lord. Because God, what does the Bible say? The Bible says that the world, there is a great shaking going on. So that the things, only the things that cannot be shaken will remain. And where are the things that cannot be shaken? Who has it? You don't know. The church. The church has it. For the world to see. So this is a challenge to myself as well. You know, wherever we are, I'm not saying everybody quit your job and come to church lah. I'm not saying that lah. Unless God tells you, then you follow, okay? But I'm just saying that, you know, even in your daily jobs, where you are, okay, it is a chance for you to learn what God is doing. All right? The church is extended into all areas. Now, apart from with God, you see, with God, it's very easy to talk, lah, right? Because God is always right, ma. Right or not? So, the problem is each other. The human biasness, fleshly eyes. This is the challenge for us. The Bible says that love covers a multitude of sins. You see, when we love one another, we accentuate each other's strengths and we cover each other's weaknesses. All right? Sometimes I feel the church, we treat each other worse than we treat our non-believer friends. Sometimes. You know? I'm not saying to make you feel bad, but I'm just saying that there's so much more that God can show us. To grow in partnership, the next point, to grow in partnership, we need to grow in our relational skills, relating to one another. You see, do you know that the phone that you have, right? I mean, it's a great tool. But if this phone is used to substitute talking to somebody, because that means you're sitting in a group, right? And then you're on your phone, and everybody else is on their phone, and nobody's talking to each other, then I think something is wrong. And let me tell you this. I think that this is the work of the times of the world to break down the relational skills of people. After a while, when you're so used to that, you cannot talk to each other already. People are saying, LOL. Hey, my daughter, LOL. Oh, what's that? I don't know. I didn't know that's a term. Hey, that's what they're using now. So in a sense, but hey, it's not the children's fault. Let me tell you that. When we go out and my kids are cranky and ding dong, what do? And you've got friends you're trying to talk to, what do? iPad to shut them up, right? iPhone. Then they're all quiet already. It is morphine injection for the parents. But if the parents are doing this to the children, how do you then later say, hey, don't be on the iPad? You're the one that cultivated it. So I'm guilty as charged. all of us. But even we ourselves, the phone is a very good companion when you're eating alone. Right or not? You go to a restaurant, you're alone. Then you're on the phone, okay lah. Nobody else to talk to ma. Right? You go and say hi to the next guy, you think you're crazy, right? But I'm just saying that. But then when you are with friends and everybody on the phone, I think something is wrong lah. So in the church, this is a practical way I'm talking about. I say we need to grow in our relational skills to one another. There are some people who are better at relational skills, better at knowing how to EQ, you know, how to talk to people and all that. There are some people who just no clue. You know, when you wear a dress, ayo, this dress made you look very fat. Maybe it does make you look fat, but you know, they make it very clear. You know, but I'm just saying, okay, we grow in relational skills. You see, with God, we interact. What is it, relational skill with God? The ability to talk to Him, to hear what He's saying, and then to obey. Relational skill with God. With men, like what I said, it's a little bit tougher. You see, Paul, let me tell you, I think that Paul's relational skills were not good at the beginning. Do you know why? Because he was busy killing people. No, really. How good do you think his relational skill was? Die! You know? That's his relational skill. So his relational skill probably wasn't very, very good. He's very cutthroat. Therefore, I say, okay, this week, my KPI, I collected 10. Huh? Well, I managed to convert 7 back, you know. 3 don't convert. Very effective person. Very effective. But if you look towards the end of the later writings of Paul, you know when Paul writes all the names, you know, when he say, and please send my regards to so-and-so and so-and-so and so-and-so, you know, all the names at the back there? These are all his leaders together. His relational skills improve. He was able to talk to other people. And let me tell you, he learned it from Barnabas as a partner. So, one way for each of us is to learn from one another. You see, it's not easy. This past 2 weeks, you know, I've been going through a bit of transition. And when you are alone or you're doing stuff, right, you don't realize that you are a certain way until somebody tells you, correct? And when somebody, the person who tells me is my wife, lah. You know, then I'm like, why she say this? No, lah, I'm not like that. You know? But then, I don't know, as I was preparing this message, okay, wife, recording, I hope you don't mind, she's not here, but wife, I hope you don't mind. We got into a little bit of a, you know, disagreement this week, you know, on something, because I'm having problems, and then, not problems, I mean, I'm facing challenges and difficulty having to adjust and all that, and trying my best, and yet, you know, not sure, and all. So I'm busy at work. Then when I come to come home, then my problem seems bigger than her problem. So she feel that, you know, she is all about me, you know. So then until then I feel, ayah, then I don't share with you lah. But then you ask me to tell you, ma. So I tell you, and then you say it's all about me. So to me, that was my point of view, right? So I was just sitting there, Lord, why is it like that? And then I realized that this is actually a lesson for all of us to learn. When somebody who loves you, you are in partnership with that person, say something to you. Sometimes it can be said in love, sometimes, is said in honesty lah. May not be said in love, but maybe honesty. I think that it is good to humble ourselves. You know, it hurts, the truth hurts sometimes, right? But if you can take time and ask the Lord, is it true? So I asked God, it was very hard, you know, but I asked God, I say, is it true? Is it true? You know, that, you know, I'm a certain way. Is it true? You know, think. Then I realized, actually, it's true. It's true. And so when you come to that point of accepting that painful, feedback about yourself, and then you accept it and you then ask the Lord, and the Lord helps you to change and you improve, what happens? You have just grown, right? You have just grown from something that you were not to something better. And this is what partnership is about in the church, where we are mirrors for one another. In Proverbs, everybody knows this. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. All right? We always think we are right. It's normal. But when we are able to see it from somebody else's perspective, and look at ourselves, then, first of all, of course, there are two reactions. One reaction is you accept it. This is when you accept it. The other reaction is you start kicking yourself. Why am I so stupid? Why am I so lousy? Why am I, you know, I mean, they go the other way. Don't go that way. When somebody that you love or that you trust tells you something about yourself, you go back and think about it. If it is true, you accept it. You say thank you. All right? But we must learn how to say it in love. So I'm saying this, that as we grow with each other, it's not, you see, it takes commitment, you know. It takes commitment. Because you know why? This world now is, you tell me something I don't like to hear, I chow lah. Bye. Right. People fight about it in marriages. Fight. Okay lah, divorce. Let me tell you, it's harder to stay and work through it than it is to run. But the reward is more rewarding. I've seen families where, you know, one person takes off and leaves, leaving the family. And do you know, for years, it is a lifetime of pain for both sides. Not just one side, it's for both sides. Lifetime of pain. Some of us here may have gone through that. You know. And God's healing is available for you. And God's restoration is available But I'm just saying that when we say in a church, you know, we say, oh, I don't like this, okay, I leave. It's not, there's no commitment. What's commitment? Because God wants us to shape, in a sense, as we listen to His Word, we learn from Him, we teach each other, we help each other along the way. We grow. Very quiet. The church is family. It is. If we don't have each other, who do you have? The society that we are living now is a society where people are crying out to belong somewhere. And God's answer is the church. For each of us to love one another, to understand His purpose for us, all right? And to know that we are part of something that is unbreakable. No matter where you run, you're still part of the church. Body of Christ. Because you are in partnership with God. And this is His family. He is your Father. And so if there are differences and all that, sit down, talk to each other. Grow in your relational skills. Rather than just say, oh yeah, I don't like the way they talk. No need to come to church. Do this, that. It's not the way. All right? This is God's family. If we don't have each other, who else do we have? This morning as I was driving into church, just pay the $2 parking, you know, drive down the ramp. And I see different church members coming. And then it's like the Holy Spirit, you know, just give me a little bit of joy in my heart, you know. Hey, this is your family. Hey, they're all coming to worship together. You know, there was a sense of like, this is what I belong to, you know. And TNCC, if you choose this is where you belong, then stay here and grow. Join the community groups, you know, have a group together. I mean, you may not be able to relate to everyone, but I'm just saying, wherever you are, grow. All right? Now, leading, last point. Leading in partnership. The leadership pattern of partnership is different. It is one where we lead not as an authoritarian style. You do this. You know? More as a together style. That means side by side. Bringing each other up. You know, good. Encouraging each other. That's why Barnabas was such a good partner, a good leader in the partnership. Let me tell you this. You know, Barnabas, I didn't know this also. In, I think, Acts chapter 9, when Paul, Saul, just converted, and then the scales fell off his eyes, and he now believed in Jesus, then he went to go and preach, all right? When he came to Jerusalem, or rather, all the Christians were still scared of him. You remember that or not? Hey, here is the Terminator, you know. And then now he became a Christian, you know. Arnold Schwarzenegger, no, not Arnold Schwarzenegger. But I mean the Terminator, the guy that you're running away from, right? Now come to church, you know. You'll be scared, right? But who was the one that took Paul and vouched for him? It was Barnabas. Barnabas was the one that took Paul. Come. Grab him. Then he's feeling, you know, everybody reject him in the church. He also scared, you know. Put him there. All the church leaders and Barnabas said, I tell you guys, this guy, good. Then all the rest, really? Yes. Barnabas was the one. And then Barnabas was doing so well in Antioch. He went out the way, going, get Saul, come. And then together, because why? Apart from the fact that God said it, God was the one that actually there's His purpose for Saul. So you may have a brother or sister here that may have some, you're afraid of them, or there's something there that, you know, Hey, but how do you know what God's purpose is for their life? Maybe God wants them to be a great tool in the church. Can you be the Barnabas? Every one of your friends are all siam this person, you know. But you stand there and say, this guy, I vouch for him. I stand up for him. Can we do that for each other in TNCC? It's a message to all of us here. Don't siam the people that you... Okay, those who don't know, siam means avoid or, you know, go away from. I don't know how to say. Hokkien, very good one. The meaning of the word. But I'm just saying, okay, let's encourage one another. The greatest tool is not criticism. You think, aya, you're so stupid, aya, 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 like that. Is the best way to bring the person up. I mean, Chinese upbringing is like that. But God doesn't do that with us, you know. Huh? God says, come on, you can do it. You feel this one. Never mind. Get up. Go again. Encourage one another. Be a Barnabas to someone, son of encouragement. And then Paul writes this, therefore, encourage one another. So this is Paul, you know, because he has experienced the encouragement from Barnabas. Paul now writes to all the churches, writes to the Thessalonians, say, encourage one another and build each other up. That is the model of leadership for the church. That's the reason why Jesus came to be man and to walk alongside us shoulder to shoulder, to bring them up, to bring us up. And that's why he makes his tabernacle now with each of us, not from on high, in the midst of us, Emmanuel, God with us. And so for us to grow in relational skills, to understand that God has a plan for each one of our lives, even the brother that you don't like, you know, or the sister that you cannot stand, God has a plan for their life, just as He has a plan for your life. Okay? So in summary, partnership is God's model. Partnership is the goal, right? Partnership is not a means to an end. It's not a means to an end. Partnership is what God wants as the model in the church. Partnership is premised on Jesus and sealed in love. Partnership allows us to tap into power. Growing in partnership can be painful, but it is worth it. It is worth it. Amen. Let's rise. You have the worship team up. Maybe spend a few moments. Think about maybe a point that was said today that the Lord is speaking to you. Father, I want to pray for all of us who are here. Lord, that you have such a great plan for the church beyond what we can ever imagine. And you are now speaking to us and telling us of this plan and how it is true partnership with each other. We don't need to worry about the result. We just look at you, look at each other, listen to you, love one another, support one another. You have put us all here for a purpose. And the purpose is partnership with one another. Relating to one another, encouraging each other, helping in a time of need. When the person calls, when a brother calls you, there's help, you help. And actually, I have seen this in TNCC. I have seen it in the church. I've seen a freedom, a willingness to partner with one another, to give to each other. Even when, you know, from the worldly perspective, it seems like it's not a wise thing to do. But we are not the world. We are a peculiar people that God has called. And we are all partners with one another, whether we like it or not. But it is in this partnership that we will find power, we will find strength, we will find great things being done. Father, open our eyes to see. And Lord, the rest of this week as we go out, Lord, that your Spirit will speak to us. Give us that paradigm shift. Give us that changing of our mind that we may be transformed. That there is a metanoia in terms of this. And there is growth, Lord. We thank you for this series of acts that we've covered. How you have led the church at the beginning. And now, we are the church at the end. And Father, you have a great purpose. You are bringing it all to completion in this day and age. And I pray for my brothers and sisters, we are all part of this great movement that you have for us. All of us to play a different part. God has put us, positioned us in different places. There is a purpose for us coming together every Sunday, but not just every Sunday, throughout the week of belonging in TNCC. There is a purpose. Father, I thank you that you will reveal, Lord, who to talk to and how to love one another. Thank you that you're growing us. Thank you that you love us. You love us so much. You want us to experience love, fulfillment, peace, rest, power, significance in Jesus. And for those of us who are here who maybe have not accepted Jesus as Lord, you say, I want in on this partnership. All you need to do is just to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And if you would, you can just pray after me. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you gave Jesus your Son to lead us out of darkness into everlasting light. That Jesus gave his life for me. He died on the cross. There was a divine exchange at the cross. All my sins were nailed to the cross with Jesus. And his righteousness is put on me. And now I am the righteousness of God in Christ. And now I am new. I've risen from the ashes. I am a new creation. I'm a child of God. And I am in partnership with your body. I thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah.